Thank you, thank you. We're going to start passing some sign-up sheets around, and I'll start that right after the offering. There is a memorial service here on Tuesday for Nadine Wright, not related to the Wrights that are sitting right here, but another family we've been connected with for several years. And if you can help with a dessert or bottled water for Tuesday at about noon, that would be terrific. So that's the sign-up sheet that's going to be going around. Let's pray. Father, thanks for life. Thank you for the joy and the enthusiasm that these kids have brought to us today. Thank you for the privilege that was ours here at New Hope to host Vacation Bible School. And I trust, Father, the lessons they learned and the Bible stories that were taught to them. And Father, it would be an unusual Vacation Bible School if there wasn't at least a couple of young people who invited Jesus Christ to be their Savior and Lord. And so we thank you for those opportunities that were ours to share. Thank you for the families who entrusted their sons and their daughters to us this week. And I trust, Father, that they realized this was a good investment of their time. Thank you for the privilege of worshiping you today. And one of those ways in which we worship is the offering of our gifts to you. So thank you for the opportunity to share from our financial resources the blessings you've given to us. In the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
I'm feeling good, good, good in a crazy way. God's love changed me more than I can say. Can't keep this in, gotta let it out. Gonna tell the whole world that your love is spinning me round and around. Yeah, it's turning me upside down. I can't believe the way you love me more than I can contain. I'm gonna turn around and give it away.
Job, guys, it looks like you had a week of faith and fun around here. Thanks for being with us. It takes a lot of volunteers to take care of 85 to 100 kids every night. And the head leader of all this, Melissa Hutchinson, turn and face the parents. Thank you. Thank you. All right, guys, head over to Sunday school. Thanks for coming. Come back next service. Do it again. All right? Bye, guys. The one thing we'll be doing in the next service we are not doing in this one is we have a baby dedication on the next service. Joan Den Hartog turned 80 yesterday, and we're not dedicating her baby, but we are dedicating her great-grandbaby, all right, in the third service today. So that's the reason, actually, I wore the tie was for baby pictures, all right? Otherwise, I'd have been in a short-sleeve shirt, and if I wouldn't scare you, I'd wear shorts. But anyway, it's great to have you here. Let me highlight a few announcements, and then I do have some prayer requests. Firework booth opens today, so after service, if you want to get some fireworks for the 4th of July, pick them up out there. All of the proceeds from those sales go to help two things here at New Hope. It helps cut the cost of our high school kids going to summer camp. You drop $500 for every high school kid who wants to go to church camp. And if you've got two teenagers, you've just dropped a grand. All right, so we do our best to help reduce those costs, and part of that is done by the fireworks stand out there. And then it takes adults to be with our kids out there because you got to be over 18 to sell fireworks. So Celebrate Recovery teams up with our youth program, and they split the proceeds. All right, and so it helps with our Celebrate Recovery ministry and with our high school camp. So send your friends and neighbors over there. On the 4th of July, right here at the church, just like always, kind of our tradition, it's a no-host potluck barbecue. The big barbecue pit will be all fired up. And, in fact, I could use a couple of men, if you would let me know, take a card out of the pew and hand it to one of the ushers or me when you leave. I have a wedding up at China Peak on the 4th of July. And so I will not be able to be here, and I could use some help to help Gene and anybody else who can be here that can make sure we got the barbecue stuff ready to go. We'll give you the keys to things you need, but if you can help out, you bring your own food, you barbecue it on the big barbecue pit, you can bring your own lounge chairs, kick back, relax. Things will start around 6:30, and when it gets dark, the fireworks go off over at Buchanan, and everybody puts their chairs out in the parking lot and face west and watch everything that goes off. But if you can help out, please let us know. And always bring a little extra, because it's not unusual for us to have people driving by wanting to know what's going on, and they often get invited to stay, and so we feed them. So that'll be on the 4th of July right here. Then next Sunday night, we are having an ordination service here at the church for Matt Actis, all right? As Matt gets ready to head back to Columbia the following week, he's going to go back as an ordained minister of the gospel. So we will have an ordination service at 6 p.m., not 7 p.m., 6 p.m. And Any of you be willing to make a gallon of homemade ice cream for a little dessert afterwards? We had a couple in the 8 o'clock service. Anybody raise your hand? Say, yeah, okay, got one back there. Anybody else? We need probably about 10. I got one there. Okay, we're halfway there. Last service, I have to keep asking until we get 5 more. All right? And here's the deal. If we don't get 10, then I'm going to send an email out and say, can you go by and buy some Baskin-Robbins or, you know, and bring it so we have enough for everybody. Isn't it great? We're talking about 40 days to a healthier you, and we're serving homemade ice cream next week. All right, I love it. All in moderation. We are going to have ice cream police at the line. You can only go through once, and we will weigh the poundage of the ice cream as it goes by. All right? Prison Fellowship Appreciation Luncheon on the 13th. You heard about that last week, just a reminder. We are going to be losing 2 of our young families this summer. They are moving out of state, and for one of those families, today is their last Sunday. The Fish family, they are back there where they always are, on my left. Would you stand? All right, this is Joe Jr., all right, and the rest of the guppies, all right, in the Fish family. And we're missing a dog. She's over in Sunday school, but man, they have been here. How long ago did I marry you two? 17 years ago, you had hair on the top of your head and not on your chin back then, all right? And but it's been a good move for you. That was a wise decision you made, and I love those kids, those boys. I love seeing them every Sunday and them running up to me and busting my knuckles and giving me hugs. And I'm going to miss you during the school year because they get on the bus in front of my house and they get dropped off in front of my house. And so during the week, I often get to see them a couple of times. And they are moving. So I'm going to cry when you leave, okay? But you have to come back and visit. And so there's a job opportunity and some educational opportunities, and they're going to give the state of Virginia a try. Here's the promise I want you to make in front of all these witnesses, okay? If it doesn't work, you won't be too proud to come back home. Okay, all right, that's a deal. All right, good. Thank you. We love you. We're going to miss you immensely. We won't say goodbye to the Ruiz family yet. They have another month or so with us, but they are moving to Fort Worth, Texas. All right, job and work is taking them there. And how long ago did I marry y'all? 6 years ago. So really, guys, you have no idea when you've had the privilege of marrying and dedicating the babies and hugging those kids every single week from infancy, and it just takes a part with you. All right. And so we are going to definitely miss them. Let's see here. I took care of that one. We're going to have another VBS. I hope you read about it right down here in the bulletin. We're going to do one in the park. We've never done this. We are going to reach out to people who live in and around the park, all right, in downtown Clovis, there at Sierra and Clovis Avenue. We're going to take the leftover stuff, all right, that we've been using here, and we're going to reuse it. And this is the brainchild of our children's ministries coordinator, all right, Jennifer Addis. And so if you would like to help in that, who can give me more info on it? This is going to be a morning event, isn't it? Kind of morning through lunchtime? Mark, yeah? 9 to 12, if I'd read the directions in here. 9 to 11:30, okay? And the dates are on here, right? Yeah, 7:22 to 7:24, so almost a month away. And if you would like to help during those 3 days, 22nd, 23rd, 24th, if you can help for one day or all three, sign up. All right, take a card out, one of the cards in the pew, put on it, VBS in the park, and with your name and number, and we'll get it to Jennifer, and she will follow up with you. All right, but I am so excited about that. Let me take care of a few prayer requests. Jay Wagner is normally here in this service. His wife is back there. Lynn Powell is working the computer back there. It's her daddy. He had another stroke. In fact, I just heard 8 strokes, okay, and he is at Clovis Community Hospital. And so please be praying for Jay while he's there, and wisdom for the doctors as they determine how best to respond to all this. We have 3 memorial services this coming week. On Thursday, Cheryl Adams, part of my extended family, her mother Peggy passed away, And that service is going to be in Taft on Thursday. Then on Tuesday, we have Nadine Wright's service here. Nadine attended our church for a while after her husband passed away until her health did not allow it. And she went home to be with the Lord last week. And that service will be here. And then tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock at Clovis Cemetery, one of the members of our church, part of the 8 o'clock service, Judy DeVecchio, 60 years old, passed away last week. And that service is tomorrow. And I'm gonna talk about this a little longer than I normally do. First off, I barely can remember going to church in my life where Judy and her family was not a part of the church. Judy's mother brought their family to the church that Dad started in Clovis in 1959 over on Peach Avenue. And Helen gave her life to the Lord on Easter Sunday of 1960. And they have been part. The sad thing for them is they've never known another pastor except a Roland. Okay? Dad had been their pastor for many years, and then the last several, I have been their pastor. Judy's mom, Helen, who was very active here in our church, one of my Sunday school teachers when I was a little kid, she went home to be with the Lord in 2009. We had a service here. Judy, her youngest daughter, Joni, their youngest daughter, Judy's younger sister, had special needs, and Judy passed away in 2012, and Judy had to handle those services for Joni as well as for her mom. Judy has not been in great health for the last several years. She works for the County of Fresno in the DA's office and many surgeries, but passed away last week. There's really no other family. Her father, her birth father, is living. He has been in a care facility since 1968, and so this is it. This is it. And here's what breaks my heart. She pretty much died alone. Pretty much died alone. Part of that, I have to be honest, is part of her choosing. And it's what I want to talk to all of us about for just a couple of minutes this morning. I've known Judy all of my life, as long as I can remember. Been a regular 8 o'clock, her little table there of ladies that she would always sit with. And for the last year and a half, 2 years, they would call. They would ask me, Tim, have you seen her? Because sometimes we would go 2 months, 3 months, not see her. And we would call. We would leave messages, not get an answer, not get a response. She'd show up, and I'd say, Judy, where you been? Oh, I was in Stanford. I had surgery, and it took me a while to recover. Judy, let us know. We would have liked to have been there. Oh, I don't want to bother anybody. She got sick, went to the hospital, and died alone in a hospital. Hey. And I had a gentleman who's a friend of the family, helped him with some things, actually get mad at us. Got mad at me yesterday. How come y'all weren't there? I said, did you ever once pick up a phone and let us know she was there? We call, we leave messages. Ladies at her table call, leave messages. Just don't know. But it breaks my heart. It breaks my heart. And here's my challenge to you. You're going to hear more about this in the sermon. It is the reason you need to connect to New Hope in a small group. You need to. You don't need to do life alone. And some of you are going to say, Tim, I am just too busy. Eliminate something. You need to connect. Just showing up on Sunday mornings and then things like this happen and we get word absolutely breaks my heart. Gene would have gone. The women in that Bible study would have sit at her table in morning worship. Dad, Janice, we would have gone. But we have to know. You got to talk to us about those things. So service is tomorrow, graveside service only, 10 o'clock. If any of you knew her, would love to have you there. It's going to be a very small group, I'm confident. So if you knew her, would love to have you there. We're probably just going to come back to the church afterwards and just have maybe some coffee and pastries afterwards and visit for a few minutes. She'll probably have a few friends from where she worked that will be here as well. So anyway, my heart breaks over all of that. So please, take that to heart and connect. It is so very, very important. Now I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward as we have our morning tithes and offering. I know, but I always do it at this time, so can't we? Can we just do it again? All right? There is a particular group of churches that after the offering is taken, the ushers count it, and if there wasn't enough in it, they take the offering again. No, I'm serious. Not here to speak disparagingly, but that is the way they do it. They count it, they come back. Nope, sorry, didn't give it up. But we've never done that. What are we doing now? Worship. All right, yeah, high school groups with us. All right, come lead us in worship, guys. I invite you to take your Bibles and find the book of Romans chapter 12, the same place where we were last Sunday. As you know, we didn't finish last Sunday's sermon, so we're going to attempt to get it finished today. We are, if you're new with us today, it's your first time, we're in the second week. Actually, this is week 2B, all right? So it's kind of the third week, but we're in a series called 40 Days to a Healthier You. We're taking 6 or 7 weeks, and we're going to look at the subject as how can we be healthier next week, next month, next year than we are today. And when I talk about being healthy, I'm talking about being healthy spiritually, being healthy physically, being healthy mentally and emotionally. You can apply this to being healthy financially. If they're going to abandon you, you can go with them. They've all left you. They've run out on you. And tell them, I'll speak to them after service. So it's, how do we get there? And please understand, you may never, ever end up healthy. That's not the, but can you be healthier than you are today? You see, some of us, as we're getting older, we're never going to be as healthy as we were when we were 30. That's not the objective as we talk about this. But wherever we are, how can we be the best we can be in all of these areas of our lives down the road than we are today? If we don't think about it, if we don't plan for it, it will never, ever happen. And so that's what our challenge has been. And so last week we began to look at what are the principles for lasting change. And the book of Romans, chapter 12, verses 1 through 14, is filled with principles that can help us through this. In fact, we initially shared with you 6 principles which come out of Romans chapter 12. There's the principle of dedication, concentration, and evaluation. And there are the principles of cooperation, affirmation, and motivation. Just hit a couple of highlights on the first two that we looked at last week. The first principle is the principle of dedication. I commit my body to God. Romans chapter 12, verse 1, it says, therefore, I urge you, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies. Doesn't that just blow you away? He doesn't say, offer to me your spirit. He doesn't say, offer to me your soul, your mind, your emotion, and your will. He says, offer to me your body. Letting us know that where our body is where we are. This is important. Our bodies, in light of everything, make this as an offering to the Lord. This can be an act of worship. And is this act of worship forced or voluntary? Yeah, worship is always voluntary. Nobody can make you worship. You may come to worship, but your participation in worship is purely voluntary. You can sit in worship and not worship because you choose not to. All of us engage in worship on a voluntary basis. And that's the first law. Change is my choice to make. I have the choice to present my body as a living sacrifice or not. There are 3 ways in which we can clearly offer our bodies as an act of worship. We found out last week we can cleanse it. In other words, detox it. All right? Detox it by what we do with it, to it, and put in it. 2 Corinthians 7, 1 says, let us purify ourselves from everything that contaminates what? Do you remember? Body and spirit. Paul said it's important that we take care of not only detoxing our spirit, which comes through the forgiveness of our sin, but he says, hey, detox your body. Pay attention to this. Perfecting holiness out of reverence for God. Then he said, not only by cleansing it, but then by caring for our body. And last of all, he said, by controlling our body. 2 verses jumped out at me last week. 1 Thessalonians 4:4. Each of us should learn to control our own what? Body. You guys are figuring this out, all right? Here's the deal. Today's sermon, any question I ask, the answer won't be Jesus. It will be body, okay? Pretty much body here, all right? I didn't say a pretty body, I just said pretty much our body, okay? Each of you should learn to control his own body in a way that is holy and honorable. God connects our physical life to holiness in 1 Thessalonians 4:4. Then in 1 Corinthians 9:27, Paul says, I discipline my body like an athlete. Like an athlete, training to do what it should do. This is what God has to say about how you and I should care for, cleanse and control our body. The second principle we looked at last week was the principle of concentration. And this is found in verse 2 of Romans chapter 12. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, the way the world thinks. Don't give in to peer pressure of all the magazines and the TV advertisements, all right? But be transformed by the renewing of our mind. If there's going to be a change in us physically and financially and spiritually, there must be a change in the way in which we think. Okay? What gets our mind gets our attention. And the scripture says, let your mind be transformed. This is not just an overhaul. This is a transformation. And he says, how do you do this? By making the choice not to conform any longer. In other words, we've done that long enough. Let's stop conforming to what the world wants. You remember, I told you I listened last week to a video on YouTube about a guy who said, I've got a surefire way to give you six-pack abs. Remember that? And after I listened to it for a while, you remember what I told you was the motivation? He said most people want to have six-pack abs. It's so the ladies will touch it. Wrong motivation, folks. That's being conformed to the world. Quite frankly, I can probably never ever have six-pack abs again, all right? It's probably just not feasible. But do you know what? I don't need to have a keg either. There's probably something in between six-pack abs and a keg, all right, that is doable. But it has to be a thought. But what's the purpose for it? We've got to think that through with our minds. Because too often when we are conformed by this world, we create habits and hurts and hang-ups that are destructive to us so that we are not as healthy as we can be in all these areas of our lives. And the second law of change from God's Word is to change, I must change my model. My model must no longer be the things of this world, but my model must be the person of Jesus Christ. All right, that brings us to the third principle, and I think I whipped through that one last week. We're going to spend a little more time there, and we're going to get this thing finished today. At least I did in the last service. I think we can do this. If I were to call, let's see here, who shall I pick on? If I were to call Jerry Lewis and say, Jerry, I'm coming to your house for dinner tonight. I shouldn't have picked Jerry Lewis because I've been to his house for dinner before. So I know how to get to him. Maybe that's why I picked his house, because his wife is a really good cook. Yeah, it's a small group you want to get in. But not while you're doing 40 days to a healthier you, okay? All right. Somebody raise your hand. I've never been to your house. John Realhorn, I've never been to your house yet. All right? I call you up and I say, hey, John, I'm coming to your house tomorrow night for dinner. And I'm going to ask you, tell me how to get there. What are you going to ask me? Where are you coming from? It's exactly correct. You see, in order to get to where we want to go, we got to know where we are. That requires a little bit of evaluation, and that's principle number 3. I must humbly assess my current state. I use the word humbly, and it's very important here. As we assess who we are and where we are, we must do this with great humility and not pride. Pride causes us to not see things that we should see and to see things that we shouldn't see. Let me tell you what's humbling. It's standing in front of a full-length mirror, buck naked. It's humbling. I stood there several months ago and I turned sideways and I said, I have man boobs. And I was humbled. I was humbled. I had to take a step up in pants when I bought my last suit before Christmas. I remember a time in my life, guys, when I laughed at people whose waist size was a larger number than their length size. I used to say, those people are crazy. And you know what? Mine has been past that for 30 years. And it went up. You know, I didn't mind it so bad when they were the same. Thought, okay, and it stayed there for a while, and then it's each 5 or 6 years. And finally I went to the guy at the store. I almost slapped the suit guy. See, and he said, you need to go up a size. And I said, I think you should check that again. And then I stood in front of there. It's very humbling. It's also very humbling to stand in front of God's Word spiritually naked. And discover what you are, a sinner in need of a Savior. And see, until you come to that conclusion, you don't need a Savior. Until you come to a point where you admit you are a sinner, there is no need for a Savior. You are your own God. The Scripture says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but God loved every single one of us, no matter how far short we fell. And by the way, two grown men, past the midway point in life, past 50, in the last 2 weeks, have invited Jesus Christ into their heart. One of them in my office week before last, and one of them on the phone with Dad yesterday afternoon, Glenn Mattson's brother. He's under hospice care in Bakersfield. He's a couple of years older than I am. John has lived a hard life. He was a product of the late 60s and early 70s, and he was a pothead and dopey. I did a wedding for his daughter, and it impacted the next generation. It's the only wedding I've ever had to hold the groom up because he was so drunk he couldn't stand on his own. I now make a speech every night at rehearsal. No alcohol before the wedding. Hey, that's not doing that anymore. But John's wife passed away last week. Glenn was down there with him, and Glenn's concerned about his spiritual condition, and he asked him, and he said, could you have Brother Lonnie call me? Dad's, you know, hearing is not the best, and so we've made arrangements to use the speakerphone in the office yesterday, and I'd called John on Friday and said, okay, Dad'll be here, and I think he can hear you this way. And so we called, not sure exactly what was going to happen, and so Pops talked to him for a couple of minutes, and he said, Brother Lonnie, you probably don't remember this, but 45 years ago, I stood in a pew during an invitation, an altar call at church, and you walked back and you whispered in my ear, John, you can harden your heart so long that one day it gets so hard, you never hear the voice of God again. And he said, that statement has haunted me for the last 45 years. But I'm here to tell you, it didn't get that hard. And I'm giving my life to Jesus Christ. It's terrific. But that's what happens. We have to be willing to stand bare before the Word of God. No pride. You and I must come to a place that we have to admit we don't have it all together. I threw this line at you. I'd rather admit I don't have it all together in order to get it all together than to pretend that I don't have it all together. And that's where we have to come to. Verse 3 says, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought. That requires humility. But rather, think of yourself, in other words, evaluate with sober judgment, be realistic, in accordance with the measure of faith that God has given to you. First, he says, don't think more highly of yourself. Be humble or you stumble. Be honest, be authentic, be real, be humble. Think of yourself with sober judgment. Be realistic. Be honest as you estimate. Give an estimate of yourself. Let me ask you a few honest questions. What are you pretending isn't a problem in your life? What are you pretending every day is not a problem for you? What are you pretending is not an issue in your marriage? What are you pretending is not a problem with your finances? What are you pretending isn't a problem with your health? Men, I don't need to go to the doctor. I'm fine. Any of you all ever heard that from your husbands? Do you have enough courage to confront yourself? That's what this verse is all about. Went to see my eye doctor last week, all right? He said, Tim, it's been 4.5 years. Why'd you show up this week? And I told him. I told him about the series that we're doing. I said, you know, man, I hit another decade before this year is over. Okay? I know. I'll be in my 50s at the end of this year. Because the 60s are the new 40s, okay? And I said, I want to know where I am. He said, that's fair enough. Glad you came back. Evaluate humbly. Find out where we are. Evaluate with sober judgment. For what purpose? Circle in that verse, if you will, measure of faith. Measure of faith. Without faith, the Bible says, it's impossible to please God. So we're going to need what is the measure of faith that we've got. We need to know where we are because it is on the basis of faith that change will come. And how do we get more faith? How do we get healthier in our faith? The Bible says it this way: faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Our reading the book, our exposing ourselves to teaching and to preaching, us being engaged in small group where we can dialogue about how does this truth apply to my life. This is the soul food that stretches our faith. And why is it important? Because limited faith means a limited future. Unlimited faith means an unlimited future, because the Bible said, according to your faith, it will be done unto you. This is what Jesus said himself. He says, we need to know what is the measure. Take measure of your faith. There's nothing wrong with having small faith. There is something wrong with staying small in your faith. There's nothing wrong with being a baby Christian. There is something wrong being a Christian for 30 years and still being a baby. That's a problem. Take measure. Where are you? Humbly admit where you are. The third law of change is, I can only manage what I measure. If we don't measure it, we cannot manage. But if I don't know the measure of my faith, I can't manage, but I can't grow in it. If I don't know the measure of my health, I can't develop and improve my health. If I don't know the measure of where I am financially, I can't set financial goals. If I don't know the measure of where I am spiritually, vocationally, or relationally, then I can't develop in those areas. I must evaluate humbly and assess my current state, and I can only manage what I measure. Let me give two very practical applications. The first thing you can do in this is record your progress. Record your progress for any goal. Since I'm kind of specifically talking about the body today, let me talk about one thing. I have a free app, okay, on my phone. It's called Lose It. Okay, and it's not your mind. It's your weight. Okay? And I started doing this 2 years ago when I first kind of started heading this direction. You download it. You put in. It asks a few questions. What do you currently weigh? Current measurement. Okay? What's your goal? Where would you like to be? You put that in. How soon would you like to get there? I make this strong suggestion. Don't make it too soon. Okay? Because all those things going together, then it tells you how many calories you can have a day. So I did that for a while. Found out I could have 1,850 calories a day. Okay, to get where I wanted to. Here's the deal. Here's the way I did that. I didn't pay attention to what I ate. I just program. Once you do it, you program. Every time you eat food, you put it in, and it calculates the calories. And it tells you how much you got left. I remember one morning. I finished breakfast. I was through, man. That was it. I was done. Nothing else the rest of that day. I learned better foods to eat, all right, so I could eat more often during the day. But just one way to measure, write it down. The second thing you could do is what the principal teaches. You need to know your starting numbers. Okay, put it down. And there's four or five of them that we ought to do with our height, our weight, our waistband, our blood pressure. These things we're going to need to know as a starting point. Evaluation, humbly assess my current state. Number four, cooperation. We must have group support. We will not make all the changes we need to make or want to make or would love to make or plan to make if we try to do this by ourselves. How do I know that? Because all of us would be lighter today. We would be smaller today. We would be healthier today if we could do it by ourselves. But we don't. A group is very, very helpful. The Bible says that God wired the universe in such a way that we need each other. We do better in community than we do by ourselves. 58 times in the New Testament, the phrase one another is used. Love one another, care for one another, encourage one another, support one another, greet one another, share with one another. 58 different times. It is mutual ministry and support of each other through life. God never meant for us to be a lone ranger. And remember, even the lone ranger had Tonto. So whether you ever marry or not, that's not what I'm talking about. What we need individually and as well as married couples, we need a spiritual family that we can specifically be engaged relationally with. Judy needed it. The Bible says this in verse 4, just as our bodies have many parts and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are all parts, all of us, parts of this one body, each of us, different work to do. And since we are all part of one body in Christ, we belong to each other and we need each other. If you circle in your Bible, circle both of those. We belong to each other and we need each other. God said that about us. I don't have to go into this principle too much because we've been on this for a year and a half as we talked about small groups. Change requires community. This is not a solo issue. We can change faster. We can change better. We can change longer. We can change more completely. We can change permanently through community. The areas that you say, I can never stop doing that. I could never break that habit in life. You can break it in the context of community. It's the way Celebrate Recovery works. In community, change comes. Because there are two things that we need. There's a lot of good self-help books that will tell us what are the right things to do, but they don't provide us the two things the Bible says we must have. We must have God's power, and we must have God's community. That's what we really need for change. God's power, God's community. I didn't think I needed to read another book on small groups and churches. Over the last 2 years, I've read about 9. And a guy came by the other day from Lifeway, and he just dropped the book off, left it on the desk with the secretary, and said, "Give this to Pastor Tim." I really had no intention of reading it, except I threw it in my car, and when I went to the eye doctor appointment, I didn't have another book in the car. And so I picked it up and said, okay, I'll read it. And I came across on the opening page, first chapter, let me share this with you. Were you ever to venture just north of San Francisco into the Muir Woods, an incredible forest of sequoia trees, you would no doubt be provoked in a sense of awe over the strength and the endurance of these massive trees. Sequoias are referred to sometimes as the largest living thing on earth. They reach almost 250 feet in the air, and some of them have been there as long as 1,500 years. When you stand before their enormous trunks and beneath a canopy that's more than 20 stories above you, it's hard not to feel tiny and envious at the same time. If you could have a conversation with one, believe me, I've tried. I've talked to the trees before. Would you not want to ask, how? How have you survived this long? How have you stood the storms of this world? How have you not toppled over? Their response would be surprising. You would probably assume that deep roots would be the fundamental reason why the sequoias around you could date back not just a few decades, but all the way back to the collapse of the Roman Empire. But that is not the case with the sequoia tree. Each tree roots grows only about 4 feet into the ground, though they go 250 feet above the ground. That blew me away when I read this. The sequoia you stand before that makes you feel like an ant has not overcome the difficulties of life because of its depth. The answer doesn't lie far beneath the surface, but it lies all around the tree. If you look around at a sequoia, you will notice they only grow in groves. While their roots go only 4 feet deep into the ground, their roots intermingle with the other sequoias next to them. One tree supports another tree, and they support the third tree connected to the fifth tree, and on, one tree has its surrounding support, supporting it and keeping it strong. Each tree stands strong through the centuries because each tree has interdependent posture. No sequoia grows alone. No Christian was intended to grow alone. We need each other. The Bible says in Christ there is no difference or division between Jew or Gentile, free or slave, male or female. We are all one in Jesus Christ. It is our love in Christ and for each other that makes up all the differences of life. Principle number 5 is the principle of affirmation. I must fill my life with love. If you ever want lasting change, it must be driven by love. Why? Because love can change the unchangeable. Have you ever met a couple? Actually, have you ever met some in-laws who said, "I was terrified when my daughter married him. He was no good. He was a..." But do you know what? He has turned out to be the most awesome son-in-law. I have never heard that flipped around. I've never heard... You understand what I'm trying to say? I've never heard somebody say, "Boy, I was scared when my son married her. She was no good. He really turned around." I always hear that about the guys. But what made the change? The love. Have you ever... We've got folks here. They were here just last Sunday, standing on the stage, who, while in prison, were introduced to the love of Christ. And I've watched some of you as you find out that Fred Mindran spent so many years in prison for murder. And I've watched your jaws drop. No, there's no way he could have done that. Love changes the unchangeable. Love invigorates and revitalizes, it renews and it refreshes. Love is the most powerful force in the universe. It doesn't say, God doesn't say that he has love. The Bible doesn't say that God does love. The Bible says God is love. Love heals what cannot be healed. Love uplifts, it strengthens, it energizes, it gives energy when we don't have it. Love empowers when you don't have the power. The Bible says, incredible verse, Song of Solomon chapter 8, verse 6, love is stronger than death. Wow. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish, but have what? Everlasting life. It's true, isn't it? What Song of Solomon wrote hundreds of years before. Love is stronger than death, Jesus revealed to us. And if that is true, then love is stronger than your debt. If it is true, then love is stronger than the divorce you're contemplating. If this is true, then love is stronger than the discouragement you are dropping yourself into. Then love is stronger than the depression that you have wrapped yourself up in. Then love is stronger than the disease you've been told your body has. Then love is stronger than the doubt that you're facing. Why? Because Paul said this, it's because of the love of God. And it is because of the transformation of God in him that Paul said, if I live, I get another day to share Christ with somebody else. If I die, who cares? Because where I'm going is better than where I am. Shelly and I are trying to figure out when can we get to Disneyland this year. Hey, when can we get to Disneyland? I can't wait. I love Disneyland. When we get to the end of that, I can't wait till the gate opens. All right. In fact, I do my best to get one of those passes so I can go in before everybody else gets to go in. You would think I had grandchildren, which I don't. Ticks me off. And because now I just have to admit that I'm a juvenile and can't wait to go to Disneyland. But here's the deal. Disneyland pales in comparison to where I'm going when I die. I literally don't give a rip what day God chooses to call me home. If it is tomorrow, I am fine with that. If it is 30 years from now, I am fine with that one. To live as Christ. What brings that to bear in my life is the same thing that will bring it to bear in your life. And that is understanding the depths of the love of God for us. Verse 9 says, don't just pretend you love others. Really love them. Hate what is evil. That means sometimes we have to confront. It's called intervention. Stand on the side of good, the verse says. You've got to love enough to confront. Love each other with genuine affection. Take delight in honoring one another. I love that. Take delight in honoring each other. Hey, do you think we got time on a Sunday morning to say, how many of you lost a pound this week? How many lost in? No, we don't. Do you think we have time today to say, hey, do you love your spouse this week more than you did last week when you wanted to get rid of them? No, we don't have time for that. But you know where you do have time for that? You know where you can fulfill the reality of this verse? Small groups. I know I lied. I told you answer to every question today would be body. I was wrong. Okay, I've made up some new questions. But you can do that in small group. In a small group, when you can get together, you can say, hey, how you doing on that budget? You know what? We just paid off a credit card. Woo! Throw a party. All right? Hey, I lost 3 pounds this week. Great! Let's have some homemade ice cream at the ordination service. We celebrate. We honor. Here's the amazing thing. God has wired the universe for us to help each other. God takes care of our problems when we honor him. God is looking down to not say, I'm going to help you if you help yourself. Have you ever heard anybody quote the Bible and say that? The Bible says, help those who help themselves. Yeah, just so you know, it's not in the Bible. That is not a biblical truth. In fact, it's probably, I understand what they're trying to say. That what the Bible does say is if you don't work, you don't eat. Okay, in other words, we need to be engaged. But what the Bible does say is, hey, none of you are ever so bad that you can't help somebody else. And if you look at the time, and I don't have time to jump into Job very long today, but if you look at the life of Job, you'll find the change came in his life when he started focusing on his friends and stopped focusing on his problems. I would encourage you, if you've never read the book of Job, I would encourage you to read it. But do me a favor, don't read it on a day that you're discouraged or depressed. Okay? Because you wouldn't get to the end of the book, all right? And that's where the good news is. Remember, he had 3 friends. I mean, God took all of 10 of his kids. He took all of his wealth. He took all of his property. And he took away his health. He had boils all over him. And God only left him one thing left. He only had one relationship left. You remember who it was? his wife, and she was a nag. All right? I'm sure Job said on several occasions, God, why didn't you take her instead of everything else? Okay. But God even resurrected his love for his wife. How do I know? Because after his recovery, they had 10 more kids. Resurrected the love again. God does that. Here's what the scripture says. After Job prayed for his friends, the Lord gave him success again. And the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. That verse blew me away this week. After he prayed for his friends, who gave him very lousy advice, after Job became others' focus, God began to do a work. Last principle. Do I have time? Yeah. Motivation. How do I maintain my passion and my enthusiasm for the long haul? Somewhere somebody told me many, many years ago, the hardest point in a journey is the halfway point. It's where you often want to turn and go back. It's where you just want to quit and sit down. You set a goal, you get halfway there, you're worn out. So how do we maintain our passion and our enthusiasm? Ralph Waldo Emerson said, nothing great is ever accomplished without enthusiasm. You see, this takes more than positive thinking. And I'm not against positive thinking. Quite frankly, it's better than the alternative. Have you ever been around negative people all the time? It doesn't take long to get enough of them, does it? All right? And so positive is better than negative. But that's not what gets us through. Because the truth is, there are a lot of things in this world that we cannot be positive about. We can't be positive about a rape when it happens. We can't be positive about a spouse who has leukemia. That's not positive. All the positive thinking in the world won't get you through that. We can't be positive about politics. No, I'm not going there. You need God to get through tough times. And the way we stay passionate for a lifetime is found in the word enthusiasm. I'm going to teach you a little Greek. Enthusiasm comes from two words, en, en, and theos. All right, those two words. En in Greek, and you know what that means in English? It means in. Isn't that profound? Okay. In theos. Theos means what? God, yeah. So in God is where we get the word enthusiasm. The word Theodore comes from the same root word. So if you've been given, anybody in here named Theodore? Got any Teddy? I got a Teddy, but no Theodore. All right? Theodore means in God. Lover of God. Same thing as Dorothy in the female version. When you get in God, we will be passionate. We are not tied to our circumstances and situations, but we are tied to the rock of ages, to an eternal God. And therefore, we can be eternally enthusiastic because we are in Him. Let me wrap this up. Verse 11 and 12 tells us three ways to do this. In serving the Lord, we can maintain our enthusiasm by being joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Underline those in your Bible. Found in verse 12. Maintain your zeal. That's don't lack enthusiasm. How do we maintain zeal? Be joyful in hope. So that even when things go wrong, I can be joyful because I know God has a plan, just like Job. I can be patient even in pain. I should be patient in affliction, joyful in hope, and faithful in prayer. I can either pray or panic. I can either worry or worship. Those are my choices and my options. When we are joyful in hope, when we are patient in affliction, when we are faithful in prayer, do you know what we have available to us 24/7? God's GPS. You got a GPS in your car? Do you have a cell phone? You probably have a GPS. You may not know how to use it. Dad has a new phone I got to look at today. He's having a tough time figuring it out. Danny, give him a lesson right there, all right? Will you? But I have a GPS on my phone. I don't have one in my car, but on my phone. I can put in here, I want to go to Granbury, Texas. Never been to Granbury, Texas. It'll pull up two or three routes. It'll say choose one. I pick one, and you know what? A lady with a very irritating voice will start talking to me. She'll tell me, turn left, turn right, go straight. And you know what? If I miss a turn, if I get my right confused with my left, you know what she says? Yeah, she says, you know, recalibrate, reroute. She gets me back on track instantly. Do you realize when you and I will be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer, God's GPS, it will not necessarily keep us from getting off track, but it will let us know when we are, and it will recalibrate us to bring us back in the direction God has for us. Those are the six principles that can bring about lasting change. Let's pray. Dear God, I don't want to go another day without giving folks an opportunity to invite you to be in their life, because lasting change starts with you in us. Allowing you to control every room and every passion and every desire that we have. Father, I want all of us, once we have taken care of business with you and invited you to come live within us, then I trust, Father, all of us together can offer our bodies as living sacrifices to you. We will care and cleanse and allow our bodies to be controlled by you. We want to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, no longer controlled by the pattern of this world, but Father, allowing our lives to be transformed by your thoughts in us. Father, I want your love to flood our lives so that your incredible love can be the transforming drive of our enthusiasm and the changes that need to take place in us. Father, I want you to nurture our enthusiasm. I want you to teach us how to be joyful in hope in hopeless situations, how to be patient in affliction, because affliction is going to come. And Father, through it all, to remain faithful in our prayers with you. Father, I trust many of us are saying we give ourselves to you at this very moment. In the name of your Son, we pray. Amen and amen. The book, The Daniel Plan, will be available out in the pavilion if you'd like it. One small group has already started it, and if you'd like yours to start it, let us know. We have the materials for you. Have a great day. See you next week.